This program is brought to you by the Center for a Sustainable Today. Our world is an amazing, complex living organism, and we coexist in a symbiotic relationship. With this great power comes a great responsibility, a responsibility to ensure the future by taking steps to be sustainable today. And now, here is the host of Sustainable Today.
Hi everyone, thanks for joining us once again as we explore yet another topic related to sustainability and how we can all be more sustainable at work and at home. I'm Darcy Hitchcock.
And I'm Marcia Willard, and want to welcome you. And tonight's topic is about the green building phenomenon. We have with us in the studio tonight Jason McLennan, who is the author of The Philosophy of Sustainable Design and also the CEO of the Cascadia chapter of the Green Building Council. So welcome, Jason. We're happy to
Thank
have you.
You
here.
Great to be here.
And we'll be eager to talk to you about green building in just a minute, but first Darcy and I are going to kick around some stories about what's been in the news this month.
Yeah, so what did you find?
Well, we always have something about carbon and climate change. I found something kind of interesting, something that we don't normally think about, but it's the carbon that's embedded in our stuff.
All the products and things like that?
All the product, you know, and look in your closets and that's full of carbon. And the interesting thing is that, you know, Oregon is getting ready to pat itself on the back for hitting its targets for greenhouse gas reductions, but that's only been possible because we're not counting all the carbon that's embedded in our products that are produced from in other places, in other states or other countries, and come here, right?
Oh, isn't that interesting?
We're importing carbon. And it's interesting to think about because we think about computers, for example, and we're careful to measure the amount of energy that they use while they're in use, but virtually 58% of the lifetime consumption of, or the carbon impact of a computer occurs before you even buy it. It's all embedded in the manufacturer.
And then there's a problem at the end of its life. Yep. You know, I saw in the Oregonian that it's been a high interest lately about what to do with them afterwards. And, you know, even the new TVs, I mean, we're worried about all these old TVs going away because of the new regulations with the new high-definition TV, and all the old ones aren't going to work very well anymore. And so, but these new ones still contain lots of hazardous materials like lead and chromium and so forth. And they're also more energy-intensive. I read that the new plasma screens draw as much energy as a refrigerator. As a refrigerator!
A little more entertaining, but come on.
Really, yeah. And then the current Energy Star certification, I can't believe this. They only measure the amount of electricity consumed when the set is off. It's drawing energy. Yeah, it's when it's off. Apparently, that's going to change. Beginning January 1 in Oregon, it will start requiring manufacturers to cover the cost of recycling them, which will at least keep them out of the landfill.
Well, related to that, I found something kind of funny that there's a local TV station in Alameda County, California, that's where Oakland is. They're starting a new reality TV show called Zero Waste Challenge, where four I know, it's pretty funny, where four families compete to reduce and reuse and recycle as much as possible, and the winner gets, you know, a prize for.
Well, I hope they're watching in the middle of the night with people dragging over bags of garbage, you know, sharing garbage in the middle of the night. You know, another form of waste that's invisible is carbon. Again, we were talking about that. And according to the World Business Council on Sustainable Development, there are now 21 cities in the U.S. that are starting to measure and report on greenhouse gases. You know, it's really interesting how you slice the pie. Over 70% of greenhouse gases come from cities. Mm-hmm. And so ICLEI, this local governments for sustainability organization, has really, they and the Carbon Disclosure Project have really been working hard to make that happen, to get the cities to measure what they're using.
Well, that's encouraging. And I saw something about IKEA. We have a new IKEA store here in the area, and
with a
very big sign and lots of stuff.
Yes.
But they're investing $75 million into clean tech startup companies because they want to be able to offer energy efficient equipment and products in their stores as early as 2011. Like solar panels, they're going to be selling solar panels, which is not what I'd expect at IKEA, but good for them.
You know, that's an interesting example of how sustainability is getting organizations to think differently about their mission and all of that. Like in Oregon, a lot of businesses have been putting up solar panels on their roofs, in part because of these wonderful tax credits that we have in this state. Well, in the Oregonian, they were talking about that Pacific Power had thrown a wrench into the works, trying to ask whether or not if a third party puts solar panels on your roof, are they really a utility, and do they have to live up to all of that?
Wow.
And does net metering still work, which is an important thing where you can get basically paid back for the energy that you're creating? And fortunately, the PUC came back and said, no problem, keep going. And so that's a really good decision that came down.
Oh, good. So that's going to open the door to more net energy buildings, which is a nice segue into our topic tonight. So
Sounds good. Let me
bring Jason into the conversation here. We're real excited to have you, Jason, because we want to hear all about what the Green Building Council is doing and your new challenges. So maybe the place to start is to tell us a little bit about the GBC and the Cascadia chapter.
Sure, and first, thanks for having me. It's just a great pleasure being
good here.
I am part of an organization called Cascadia Green Building Council, and we are an education and outreach group that promotes green building, educates and advocates for green building.
And you're basically a local chapter of the national?
Yeah, actually we're pretty unique in that we're a regional chapter of both the U.S. and Canada Green Building Councils.
Oh.
We're the only dual citizenship group, and actually I'm a Canadian with a green card, so it kind of fits. I work here in Seattle, so we like to say we cover all the land where the salmon runs, and so we promote green building in Oregon, Washington, British Columbia, and Alaska, because we actually have a lot more in common than we have different, and the strategies and solutions for green building really are regional in nature, and so we are into sharing. So
good. Well,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
That's wonderful. So we've been fascinated to watch the rise of the green building movement because it took off so much faster than any other industry. So tell us a little bit about why that happened.
Well, it's not one issue, as you guys know. It's been a multitude of issues, and the movement really. And I like to call it the movement because it really feels like that when you're in it. Really started in the 70s, like a lot of the environmental movements.
Mm-hmm.
Started in the 70s and then went through about two decades of you know, really wasn't good to be in green building for about 20 years, the 80s and the 90s.
It was not too cool.
No, it wasn't cool to be green. those of us that were trying to build buildings during that time, it was tough. But really, as you've said, it's really taken off for a lot of different reasons. One is the rise of the U.S. Green Building Council and LEED, which we may talk about. And
why don't you explain what that acronym is, just in case somebody doesn't know.
Sure. Well, LEED is the premier rating system for buildings in the U.S. and in Canada, actually, and it stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, and it's how you are sure that a building really is green because it's gone through a rigorous certification program and been audited as such. And so, yeah, we can get into that, but, you know, there's a host of issues as to why green building really has taken off. It's exciting that finally green is cool.
And profitable.
And
saving money.
Yeah,
I mean, some of the research that came out that started showing if you're not doing LEED Silver, you're kind of stupid because you're wasting money. That helps.
Well, that was just going to ask about that because there's a perception that green buildings cost more and... So
yeah, that's always, that's been a myth that's been really hard to shake. It's always the first thing that people want to talk about is cost, and people believe that green always has to cost more. And what we have come to realize is that, you know, this is not a black and white issue. There are shades of green, and some things cost more and some things cost less. There is always something that you can do to improve the environmental performance of your project, your home, your office. And if you can't spend more, there's still lots that you can do. And it is possible to build a green building or a building that is significantly better performing for no cost premium. It is possible. I've done it, and a lot of other people have done it. And it really depends on how far you want to go. And then the flip side of that that people do understand is that, you know, it is a wise investment. So there are some things, if you want to go further, that have, you know, paybacks that are very reasonable and that you should just want to do.
And I would think the time horizon matters too. So, and I know that that's one of the arguments from the developer side, that if they're building something to flip and want the immediate return. But if you're going to be in a building for more than 5 years or 10 years or 20 years.
Yeah, the longer you're going to own a property, the more it makes sense, obviously, the easier it is to justify. But even for those developers that are flipping it, what they're realizing is that what they're building is a better building, and it makes the product more valuable in the marketplace, because the people that are going to be buying the building or renting the building are going to have lower utility bills. They're going to be able to attract potentially more employees to the building, that it's just a better product, and people raise. Right now, it's about competing for the best spaces available, and green building is frankly a competitive advantage for the companies that figure that out.
And can you now provide data or resources that are, you know, compelling arguments for things like? We've heard rumors about the productivity of people who operate in these buildings, who work in these buildings, their health,
Yes, and it's one of those things that for a long time it was anecdotal. You know, we believe that this is going to
feels like, and
because we knew it to be true, because we've all been in spaces without windows and spaces with windows, and we know that you work better.
Office.
Right. And so we knew these things to be true, but actually codifying the savings has been tricky.
Yeah.
But the good news is now there's enough LEED buildings built, which means that that we can actually track what they did, what environmental measures that they did. And there is enough of a track record in terms of what has been the performance and energy savings, and also what has been the reductions in absenteeism, and how do people feel in these buildings. And I think at the end of the show, if there's resources, people can go to the U.S. Green Building Council website, usgbc.org, and see some of the studies that have been done. And there are new studies coming out every year. And it really is building a case. And you know, getting back to your earlier question about, you know, green, why green is sort of taking off, is that, you know, frankly, it's that side of the equation. You know, when it was just about, you know, hugging trees, there was only a segment of the population that was interested. But when this also, in addition to that, became something that was just the right thing to do financially and for the business bottom line, suddenly all these other people began to become interested. And so those two things together.
And it makes me think, was there a perception early on? I know in the Pacific Northwest, there was a tendency to equate green or organic with pretty funky looking things, and I wonder if people meant it thought I had to do rustic paneling or
there's been a lot of myths in green building that have taken a while to shake. And certainly there is this sort of cultural memory of the 70s in terms of of how green homes in that time, they weren't called green homes, energy conserving homes, looked like. And there was definitely among people this notion that if you're going to do a green building, it's going to look like, you know, this.
Yeah.
And if they didn't
made
like
with tires,
if they didn't like that aesthetic, then there was immediately this barrier. And what we're now seeing is green buildings emerging of all building styles. And green building is not a particular aesthetic, and that's one of the things I talk about. It's a philosophical way that you approach the design of a building. It's not an aesthetic outcome. And so when you realize that, and realize that you there's a lot of flexibility in how, and really it's amazing the sort of wide range of building types that are out there. I think people are surprised when they see.
Well, let's talk about the energy angle, since that's such a big benefit of these green buildings, and we have climate change, and we have concerns about supply of energy and all of that. To what degree is green building going to be able to solve that problem? Obviously, we can't build our way out of this problem with all new buildings, so how does it help?
Well, green building is a huge piece of the puzzle, and it's bigger than people realize. If you not only think about the amount of energy that buildings use, but you were talking about products earlier, but the amount of energy embodied in the products that go into making our buildings, it's actually the largest single, you know, contributor to climate change that we have, more than transportation. Now, that's regionally based. In the Northwest, there is a different power supply than in Northeast, which is more heavily based on coal. So where the impacts are is slightly different. But buildings are a big part of the solution. And we've been building buildings in many ways for the same way for 100 years. and talk about latent potential. Our buildings are so inefficient and so inelegant in many ways that there is this the potential for us to address climate change in particular, and efficiency is so huge, is that we can design buildings that use 50, 60, 70% less energy than code compliant buildings today with off-the-shelf technologies if you have people that know what they're doing.
That's
a huge amount of reductions.
It is a huge.
It's huge.
And that's with today's technology.
That's with today's technology, yeah.
But that's new construction, right?
It's not only new construction. It's certainly easier when you have a blank slate.
Right.
But it's not only that. And we are seeing, you know, through the LEED rating system and other tools, existing buildings being retrofitted, mm-hmm. and especially the systems in old buildings that use energy, the mechanical systems, the mm-hmm. lighting systems, when those get changed and brought up to the best technologies available, it's really a huge improvement in the energy use of those buildings. So it really applies to new and existing. It has to. It's not mm-hmm. just new, as you said.
Mm-hmm. Well, yep. You've made several references to LEED, and before yep. we leave this segment of the interview, I'd love to give you a chance to talk about what LEED really is.
Sure.
And we've mentioned some of the category, the energy category, but I know there's much more to it.
Well, you know, before the creation of LEED, there was really no way, a standard way across the whole United States and in Canada, for you to tell whether a building was green. There was local programs, but there was no unified standard, and that was really important. And LEED has helped usher in a lot of the growth in the movement, is because it's very clear now that what you need to do to produce a building that deserves to be called green. And what basically LEED does is that it offers, based on what you do in your building design, offers points in several different categories: water conservation, energy conservation, materials, site development, etc. And if you do enough of these things, it's sort of like the Olympics. If you do enough, you get a medal, right?
Yeah.
And so you get, and it's not quite like the Olympics, because they have something called certified, which is their lowest end rating.
Kind of like the drug testing.
Okay. Yeah, you make it there, and then...
You make it to the Olympics.
Right, you make it to the Olympics, and then they have silver, and so bronze is sort of certified, and then you have silver and gold, and they have platinum. And platinum is the highest rating in the LEED rating system. And we're going to talk about something beyond that. So.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Yeah. Well, we'd love to talk more about that. And so you have a couple different, you've got LEED for new construction, and then you used to have LEED EB, and then now LEED O&M. So can you just rattle off quickly what some of the different categories are?
Well, there's also LEED for homes, and I bet a lot of your, you know, viewers are interested in the idea that, because really LEED started as a commercial office tool,
mm-hmm.
and that was just the first building type that the council tackled. For a variety of reasons. And so, you know, there actually are related tools like the Green Guide to Healthcare, which is a very progressive tool. It's not actually a USGBC, US Green Building Council tool, but it's based on LEED, and it's for healthcare facilities. So if you're doing a hospital or healthcare facility, that's an excellent tool. And you have LEED for homes, you have existing buildings. And all of this is in the process of being updated. And there's a new version that's coming out soon.
That's great. Well, thank you so much. Well, one of the great things about the green building movement is that builders are not out all on their own. We have LEED and the Green Building Council to help. And in Portland, we have the Office of Sustainable Development and its own green building specialist to help answer questions and push through code requirements to ensure that more green building is done in the city. Eugene Dendas paid a visit to our OSD specialist and toured his own home. This home was certified by Earth Advantage, which is a different program, yet another certification system that meets our local standards. So let's go take a look.
Our house is a very, very, very fine house with two cats in the yard. Life used to be so hard. Now everything is easy because of you.
We're here today with Michael Bryan. Hello, Mike. How are you?
Hi, Eugene.
Tell me, what is the Office of Sustainable Development?
Okay, Eugene, let's call it OSD for short.
Okay.
Because that's much easier. OSD is a group of people who work on sustainability in the city. I work on the green building team. We have people who work on solid waste and recycling, people who work on biofuels, the global warming action plan, the food policy. We also do classes, workshops, and events. Like, we've got a green home tour coming up later on this year, September 20th.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We are here at your house today, and well, why don't you just maybe introduce us into it and give us the guided tour?
Well, my wife and I were lucky enough to have the ability to build a new home in Portland, so we wanted to showcase some of the ideas that I talk about all the time with people. And that involves building a house that is very resource efficient. So for example, we have a lot of salvage materials in here. It's energy efficient, plays well with the neighbors, you know, fits into the neighborhood, has a good kind of social impact, uses as many local products as we can, and then showcases some innovations that I was particularly interested in. And an example might be, we'll take a look at the clay floor we have in this house and the clay plasters on the walls. Mm. Those are local materials that we could use here that aren't very, they're not hard to get or expensive. We're just not used to using them. So the house is a place to be able to show people what that looks like and get them to start thinking about it.
Mm-hmm. I noticed that your roof is an eco-roof. Is this something that OSD helps people do themselves?
You bet. Portland wants to manage stormwater in ways that keep it out of the river and keep water clean. And eco-roofs are a way to do that. Like you say, you're putting soil and plants up on your roof, and they have the effect of slowing water down so it has a chance to cleanse itself as it goes through the soil. Mm-hmm. And you're creating a kind of natural environment. Plus it extends the life of the roof. The roof itself will last a lot longer with the plants on it. So we like the idea of having the eco-roof, and we worked out a deal here where my wife and I bought the materials, and about 50 volunteers, mostly from the Portland State University, came over 3 weekends and installed it with us. So mm-hmm. they got to learn how to do an eco-roof, and we got one put on our house. So a person who's interested in eco-roof calls us up, and we can give them information about eco-roofs and how they're made. We can give them information about the resources that you may need, like where do you find the products that you're going to use to build one, or where do you find the skills in Portland, people who've already done it and know how to do it that you might want to hire. We put on workshops that people can go to and learn more about it. And we can actually sit down and confer with people and talk it through in more detail if they want to do that.
Mike, are there some other features outside here of the house that you might be able to tell us about?
Yeah, you bet, Eugene. One of the things that we really promote in sustainable building is the idea of making things last a long time. So those are features that are kind of invisible, but I can point some of them out to you. Mm-hmm. For example, the window frames are fiberglass, and the color is actually built into the fiberglass, so it never needs to be painted. Very low maintenance, and the frames should last indefinitely. Under the shingles, there's an airspace called a vented rain screen, and the purpose of the airspace is to let any water that gets through the siding or the shingles drain out or escape harmlessly so it doesn't cause any moisture damage in the wall. That's something that's fairly common in older houses around Portland.
Mm-hmm. So Mike, I'm really curious about this OSD hotline. Can you tell me what somebody might expect if they call?
Well, the hotline gets questions from all over the metro area, so we get a lot of variety. But here's an example. Somebody's thinking about insulating their house, and they discover right away that there's a whole variety of insulations out there. So what's the right insulation for my situation? And they'll call us up and ask us that question, and then where to go to find that insulation or find the provider.
Speaking of insulation, do you have a lot here in the house?
Well, yeah, that's one of the things that we really worked hard to make happen. And I'll compare with the code. The code says in an attic ceiling you should have R38 insulation, so probably people are used to that. Mm-hmm. Our house has R49, mm. and our trusses are a special shape to let that insulation go all the way out over the outside walls and not taper down to nothing, which is what usually happens.
Well, Mike, we're in your home now. I'm looking around, there's just so many beautiful features, natural feeling and looking textures. So much of this stuff that people can learn from OSB. Can you give us a little insight on these applications?
What you see right away on these walls around us is clay plaster. And the clay for the plaster came from the ground in Portland. And this floor that we're standing on is a clay floor. Same thing, the clay is from the ground here in Portland. You can see what it looks like under here. And clay is a local material that we're just not used to using. And it's kind of an example of what I do with OSD, is to talk to people about the ideas they have in their head and the assumptions that they hold that they may not even be aware of, to give them more choices and alternatives to use in their houses that are sustainable. And this is a very good example of that.
How do you keep it so well-tempered?
Oh, good question. Well, the insulation that we put in helps in both directions. It keeps your house cool in the summer as well as warm in the winter. The glass in the windows is glass that rejects solar gain. But maybe the biggest thing is we have a lot of thermal mass, a lot of heavy stuff in the house. We have a concrete floor all the way under the house, the clay on top of that. These blocks are filled with concrete. Its name is Durisol, D-U-R-I-S-O-L, and it's a block that's made out of recycled scrap wood. These are wood chips that are held together with some cement. The wood has been mineralized, so it looks kind of like petrified wood, and that means that insects and fungi don't want to eat it, so it will last for a long time. And you'd stack these blocks up, and you put reinforcing rods in the cores, and then fill them with concrete. So you end up with a wall that's really well insulated with the rock wool here, and the block itself has some insulation value. But also you have a lot of thermal mass now that's inside the insulation. So this is our interior wall, that's our exterior wall. And the concrete that's in these cores that are all around us is helping keep the house stable in its temperature. It's part of that thermal mass. Mm-hmm. We have the cob wall here in the middle of the house. So compared to most houses, there's a lot more heavy materials in the house that will hold heat and keep the temperature of the house steady. So because the power for the house is all wind and solar, there's no carbon emissions. Nobody burned any coal or natural gas to make our electricity. It's strictly renewable.
So is that what qualifies this home as a zero emissions home?
Correct. Oh. We're not zero energy. Pretty efficient, but we didn't push it hard enough to get to zero energy, but we're zero carbon. This is the solar tank, and you can hear it gurgling right now because it's sunny today. So water from the city water lines is going up to the collector plates on the roof. The sun's heating the water and comes back down to this tank and gets stored here. So right now the temperature in that tank is 132 degrees. And that means that this water will go straight into the house. We won't put any more energy into it. So this solar system provides all of our hot water in the summertime. In the wintertime, when it's cloudy and kind of gray outside, it'll be colder than that in the tank. And so the electric water heater will bring it up to the temperature that we want to use it for the floor and for the domestic hot water in the house. This pump is running water into the floor for the radiant hydronic heating in the floor. The whole floor warms up in the wintertime. That little controller up there connects to a thermostat that's on the outside of the house. So the house can see what's going on with the weather outside and respond accordingly. And then the colder it's getting outside, the more that controller will warm up the water going through the floor.
I'm really looking forward to researching more on OSD and how I might take on more sustainable practices. Is there any last things you want to say about the company?
I think OSD could be a good resource for you, Eugene. It's a place that where you'll find what you need to know if you want to live or work more sustainably. If you're a homeowner or a business, give us a call or look up our website. It's portlandonline.com/OSD. That's the portal to all the different services that we offer. The Green Building Hotline is 503-823-5431. And if it's not exactly a green building question, that's okay. Call us up and we'll get you connected to the right person.
Thanks, Mike. I'm Eugene Dendas, bringing you the tools to be sustainable today.
I'll light the fire. You place the flowers in the vase that you bought today. Staring at the fire for hours and hours while I listen to you play your love songs all night long.
It's so interesting, isn't it, to see all the different features that you can put into a home to make it much more green and much more sustainable.
You put your mind to it.
Yeah, absolutely. But now we want to talk about the Living Building Challenge.
Right.
Because that's like going way beyond LEED to trying to define what a fully sustainable
that's
building
right.
would be. So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, Well, I think it's interesting if you look at most of the buildings, we step outside the studio and look at most of the buildings built, they're built to code, right? Mm-hmm. And what people need to realize is that code is the worst allowable by law. That's what a code-compliant building is. And what green building standards are things to help nudge us to do better than code in environmental mm-hmm. indicators and health indicators. And so basically they're being less bad. But what if you actually flipped that on its head and said, well, what would it take to be good? What would it take to build a building that was restorative to a place and that really was truly sustainable? And that's, in essence, what we have tried to formulate and codify.
And didn't that start here in the Cascadia region?
Well, Cascadia has launched the tool. Actually, the history of the idea goes back about 12 years now. And there were projects that I was involved with in Montana, in Missouri and California and others that began the notion of a living building, but Cascadia has launched this challenge, this program, which is basically telling you what you have to do to build a building that is truly sustainable. And I like to compare it to building buildings like nature would build buildings. And we have some images behind us of nature. And imagine if our buildings could operate as elegantly and efficiently as a mm-hmm. flower. And what would that take to do that kind of impact? Well, we know that the building would generate all of its own energy with renewable energy on site. It couldn't have energy from fossil fuels or nuclear. It just wouldn't do that.
Right.
It would have to get all of its water from the amount of rainfall, snowmelt, precipitation that falls on the site. It would have to capture it and it would have to reuse it. It would have to get all of its nutrients from the soil. It couldn't pollute its environment. It would have to be incredibly elegant and responsive to climate and place, or it wouldn't be able to do this. And it had to be beautiful, which is why a flower is a perfect metaphor. And that's really what we're striving to do with living buildings.
And so that's why you have a flower on the front of the book.
Yeah, exactly. And I've talked about this in the book. And so it sounds, when you first describe it, it sounds kind of crazy, buildings like flowers, but it's actually not. It's actually, until a few hundred years ago, it's all we built were living buildings. And now we have to return again to that understanding. Yeah, out of mud. But now we have technologies and we have an understanding that we can have the level of impact of a mud house, but actually the comfort and way of living that we are more accustomed to now.
And associated with this new code, you've sort of issued a challenge to the building industry. Tell us about that.
Well, the challenge is it's really the race to see, okay, who's going to build the first living building?
Uh-huh.
Who's going to build the first living building in this state, mm-hmm. in this city? And who's going to build the first living building house, the first school, the first hospital? It's an infinite challenge. And we launched this challenge in 2006 at Green Build, which is the big green building event that held in different cities every year. And we didn't know what to expect, because this is not an easy...
How did people react?
Well,
because there's been a lot of investment in LEED. What did they think about you guys coming out going, yeah, LEED's fine, but here's this cool oath?
Yeah, no, but the thing, that's a good question.
That you'd rather not get into?
No, not at all. the Living Building Challenge is not competitive with LEED, because really, it's really talking about how pushing people beyond. And there's mm-hmm. there's so many projects that are just trying to get to the LEED level, but there is a group of people around the country that are ready for that next step and are ready to show what's possible today.
Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing a living building would qualify for LEED.
Oh, yeah. And a lot of the projects that are pursuing our challenge now are also pursuing a LEED rating. So it's not an either or thing. Mm-hmm. But we didn't know what to expect. But we've been really surprised.
Really?
And
Well,
there's projects popping up everywhere that are pursuing this. There's 12 in Portland that we know of that are trying to do this. And how many of them will get it, we don't know.
Well,
one or two.
Well, you have to get 90% of the way there.
Exactly.
Of all the innovation.
And that's exactly the point. And there is at least 60 or so around the country. And we've just launched this program. Every day we get a new call, a new email from a project that is saying, we don't know if we're going to make it where we're going for it. We have a couple under construction. I'm going to be going out to New York State. There's a project in New York State that may be finished by the end of the year that is going to try to get it. And really all over the place. And they're all building types. There's a daycare facility in Vancouver, British Columbia. You have schools. There's a community college in my hometown that is pursuing this. There's multifamily housing. And imagine all these buildings that have no energy bill. They'll never have an energy bill. They'll never have a water bill. If the city loses power, they go right on ticking, right? And it's just a different way of thinking about building. It's what we need to be doing to address these problems. And I think that in a few years, we have enough of these built that you won't be able to say anymore that it's not possible to live lightly on the land.
So you've alluded to two things,
net
zero energy and net water.
Net zero water.
So what else is involved in a living building criteria?
There's 16 things that you have to do.
Which is a lot less than the LEED criteria, right?
It is.
But there's 16 big things.
But there's 16 bigger things, and we tried to distill down the essence. It is, because of that. And so basically there's one energy requirement, only one of 16, and basically the project has to be net zero energy. So on an annual basis, the building has to generate on the building site as much energy as it consumes. So it may mean that in the summer months it generates more energy through net metering, might sell it back to the grid, and in the winter it might not generate quite enough, but it balances out over the year. That's our minimum
threshold.
That's an important thing to
mention. It doesn't mean that when the sun goes down you get cold.
No, it does not mean that. This does not mean that. A grid interactive system means that the energy is flowing in both directions, and so you always have power. And if you have a battery backup, then if the grid goes down, you can still operate. So
there's energy.
So there's energy, and then there's water, which is a very different thing for most people to think about. Is really living within the water budget of the place that you are, and in many places this is actually not legal, and there's code barriers. Is that we are in this country and in Canada.
It's not legal to live off your own rain budget.
In certain places,
or you're not allowed to use the rainwater.
You're not allowed to use rainwater. Mm-hmm. You're not allowed to clean the water in some in Colorado. You're not allowed to use your rainwater.
Or use the gray water. Right.
Yeah, great. I mean, there's a lot of restrictions, and we're actually working in a lot of jurisdictions at helping to remove some of these barriers. But imagine if, again, you didn't have a water bill, and you treated and water on, and not just water. I mean, you treated your sewage. That's a requirement. Right. So these projects either have some sort of ecological on-site waste treatment process that is, then returning the water for use again, and it's really great.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Now, wasn't there also a requirement about not taking a new space, basically not taking up new land?
Yeah, this is one that is controversial for developers, and it's the notion that as a species we've co-opted enough land. And so in the Living Building Challenge, we have a requirement that there's no new sites, that we can only build on sites that have been developed previously. So either, the whole Pearl District of Portland is a great example of an area that was an industrial area. Mm-hmm. That's perfect in reusing, cleaning up the site, bringing it to a better value, instead of continuing to sprawl further and further afield. There's 16 things, from materials to indoor air quality, and they're all challenging, but they're all really essential. We have a red list that is interesting to mention, because you can't have a living building and fill it with toxic materials. So there is simply a list of things.
A living dying building.
A dying building, which is, really, a lot of our buildings are very toxic. And when they go either in a fire or when they come down, are really a problem for us. And so we have this red list that basically says, thou shalt not. And it's really the only non-performance-based thing in the standard. Everything else is kind of based on performance. But that one is simply, you can't have these things in your building.
So we've got about another minute or so before we have to go to the next segment. Are there some really cool technologies that would be fun to mention for the viewers?
Well, there are some great technologies emerging. But the thing that we're learning about Living Building Challenge is that all the technologies are available today. You can do this now. And it's what we're learning. See, we don't have to wait.
You don't have to wait for the fuel cell.
That's the great thing. And sure, we're excited about LED lighting that is, we have LED lighting, but we're excited about LED lighting completely replacing fluorescence and eliminating mercury completely, which would be great. So those technologies, and there's much more advanced technologies for energy generation that are coming along, and smart windows and just great things. We don't even need those yet. Those are just going to make it easier.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So.
What an inspiring. That's really inspiring, and so many.
It's a lot of fun.
It shows the example. Yeah. It shows to me the power of having an inspiring vision of how much that sucks people into wanting to participate
and shaking people out of the notion that it doesn't sound possible.
Right.
And demonstrating that it is.
And that's been one of the most successful things that the program has done is mm-hmm. it's brought a lot of people to the table that have gotten really excited in places that we never even thought that would happen. And it's been really beautiful. And it's the kind of hope that we need. You know, we talk about how the inconvenient truth brought these issues to the foreground, but it leaves off before you get to the solutions.
Yeah.
And so we need to talk about living buildings and living communities as the solution to these issues that we face.
Well, that's a great lead-in to our next segment. You know, what we've been talking about is probably very inspiring, and so if you want to build something that's green or even go all the way to a living building and meet that challenge, you need to find somebody who can help you build that. We're going to work with or interview one contractor who is experienced with this. This is Ron Hayes, who takes a personal interest in this technology and building these types of homes. We're going to visit with him, and then after that, we're going to take you to the Rebuilding Center, which is a source for materials of all kinds available at bargain prices. These are largely recycled materials. Both of the features that we'll be showing you were produced by Ed Eberle and were taken from his new show, The Natural House. So here's Pam Mayhem with our new business spotlight.
The Hayes Carl Family Homestead is a 2,000 square foot timber frame bungalow that incorporates a full range of new ideas and natural materials to define its deep green building values. The home's concept was initially shaped by concerns tied to the use of toxic materials.
One of the reasons that I wanted to create a non-toxic environment was because Christy had had cancer just prior to our building. We wanted to build a house as toxin-free as possible because we didn't want to put any more environmental stress on her body.
The centuries-old building style is an earthen wall timber frame technique.
Timber frame has traditionally been the form of structure that was used throughout Europe, in Japan, in China, for thousands of years. Building with a timber frame is looking backwards in order to move forwards for a more sustainable building.
The distinctively rich timbers are fitted together by hand-cut mortise and tenon joints and held tight by wood pegs.
This house rekindled my interest in building homes that were alive for people. Having built homes for years, I've seen that you can walk into a beautiful home that doesn't have a soul. You don't feel uplifted. You don't feel alive. It's not part of the landscape.
I think a home needs to be comfortable, where people can move around in it so that they come in contact with each other in really nice ways. A home needs to meet each person's individual desires for what feels comforting to them. A large part of that for me is nature and the spirituality part. That's such a deep core part of me that it has to be reflected in my life for my house to be nurturing to me.
The deep brown natural mud and gold straw-flecked entry opens onto a serene, welcoming alcove. The earth and clay plasters covering the walls are built on a base coat of clay harvested from a nearby hillside.
What you see in the entry is the base layer of the plaster that's underneath all the walls in the house.
To guard against outgassing, ceilings, walls, and other painted areas are finished with toxin-free paints.
The natural clay has a completely different ability to affect the indoor air quality. Walls made of sheetrock and latex paint act as a barrier. These walls are completely different. These are beautiful natural walls, but what you don't see underneath them is, well, to put it simply, dirt.
Layers of straw and clay form the thermal mass behind the walls. Together with the mud plaster finish, this forms the breathable or living wall system.
Breathable walls are allowing the indoor air to migrate on a molecular level to the exterior. We call this the truth window. It reveals the inner structure of the house. The first layer is the clay and straw. The second layer is the native clay. The third layer is pottery clay. Over that, there's clay plaster mixed with pigments that give it natural color.
The house is designed around a central light core capped by two skylights and a fan that provides a naturally circulating updraft. Radiant heat rises from the concrete slab floor. To soften the earth advantage of concrete, wool rugs and soft cork flooring in the kitchen provide foot-friendly comfort.
My favorite place in the house is the meditation room. And for some reason, it has the best energy in it, the best feeling in it. It feels very peaceful. Everybody who's opened the door goes, oh. It's a sacred space. And sometimes I think it's the windows. Sometimes I think it's because of the intention we put into it. It has Ron's spiritual work, his shamanic work. It has my spiritual work with, you know, my healing and my meditation work.
Most interior wood has been reclaimed for use as door, window, and baseboard trim.
With my trim, I'm taking something that's taken nature 300, maybe 500 years to grow, and I'm giving it an opportunity to live another 200 or maybe 300 years in my house.
Outside, the low-slung concrete tiled roof with an expected lifetime of 50 years flows naturally into locally harvested cedar wall siding. Upstairs, the overlook passage serves as an office, and the scaffolding used during construction has become the office desk. The master bedroom features blue-tinted plaster walls and a balcony view of woods and a running stream. The adjacent master bath centers on a large soaking tub. Clay plaster walls and stone tile are both attractive, toxin-free alternatives to gas-emitting synthetic bathroom products. When moist, natural clay bathroom walls exude a deep, earthy fragrance, and when wet, they fully absorb moisture within minutes.
Our house demonstrates that you can use traditional and natural materials and still create a house that feels comfortable and looks conventional.
In the healing of my cancer, part of the process was learning about connecting with nature spirits. It's not like I see fairies, but I have a sense of these entities, that everything does have a spiritual essence. The plants do, the land does, the wood does, everything does. So it was a process of going inside and calling them in, calling in the deva of the land, calling in the deva of our family, calling in the deva of the house, and asking them what it was that we were supposed to build. And so oftentimes we'd get to a place and Ron would say, what do you think? And I'd say, I don't know. I don't think these things. I have to go inside and ask, because it's not like my personal preference. It's what's to be done here, what's right, because I have a very small, narrow vision of what would be right for me, but this is bigger. Life's bigger than just me.
There are so many brand new products reaching the green market every day, but the three R's of the sustainable building world will always be recycle, reuse, and renew. And at Portland's world-famous Rebuilding Center, they're finding a new purpose and a new life for just about everything. A day's end destination for builders and contractors, the center receives an average of 6 tons of used materials daily, material that would otherwise have found its way into landfills.
The Rebuilding Center is recognized as one of the first steps in green building. Whenever somebody's going to do a remodel or a new development, if there's existing materials there, the first step is keeping those materials out of the landfill.
The nonprofit center sells used building and remodeling materials from a 52,000 square foot warehouse. Sustainable building is not just about what's green or not. It's also about finding value in recycled materials. At Portland's Rebuilding Center, customers can find just about anything they need for reuse and other construction projects.
The Rebuilding Center accepts the largest variety of used building materials out of any place in our region. We literally accept anything from a doorknob to an entire home. So you can find doorknobs, lumber to build a home. Everything that you would find in a new building materials store, you'll find here and more.
The Rebuilding Center is the largest nonprofit used building materials resource in North America.
If people are doing a remodel and they want to find things that match what already exists in their home, especially if they have an older home, this is a great resource. Our inventory changes on average every 15 minutes. And we move through here on average 7 tons a day, which is about the equivalent of 3 to 5 20-foot flatbed truckloads each day. I always tell people, if you don't find it here today, you can check tomorrow. It's just kind of got some great energy that way.
Looking for a hot tub, chandelier, wood beam, or doorknob? Chances are you'll find it at a rebuilding center near you.
La, 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 la.
Really nice of Natural House to share that all of that video with us. It looks like a great show, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, this is the part of the show where we try to give you ideas of things that you can do at home and at work to be more sustainable. So for existing homes, some things to think about, of course, and these are probably obvious, but it's worth mentioning again, energy-saving devices. When you go to get appliances, go and get the ones that have Energy Star labels. Obviously turn stuff off when you don't really need it on. Water saving devices, you can usually go to your own water bureau and they may have flow restrictors and things like that that they will give you for free. Water harvesting or runoff management, rather than having your rainwater just go whooshing down the pipes and into the waste treatment center, you can divert it and use it, store it. Weatherize your house, and also think about the landscaping. That's a major water hog around here, especially when we have so much dry weather in the summer. So those are things that you can do at your home to make a difference.
And if you're contemplating building a new home, well, there are all the things that we talked about with Jason, and we'd encourage you to check out some of the certification schemes that are available, particularly LEED for homes or the Earth Advantage scheme, or if you want to go all the way, look at the living buildings. And it will instruct you and give you ideas about things like using recycled materials in your home, looking for different technologies, especially around energy. Solar is becoming within reach, and there are some great tax credits here in Oregon if you want to pursue that. At least for hot water, it's already being demonstrated that it's very cost effective to do solar hot water. If you're a business, it's a little different. Most businesses don't have the luxury of controlling the buildings that they're in, but we would encourage you to push on your landlords or your leases and at least start asking for things like energy efficient lighting or appliances or mechanical systems. You might have more leeway and more leverage there than you imagine.
Maybe even have them buy green power,
ask your landlord to buy green power. You know, it's especially if you're willing to foot the bill for that. It's only a few extra dollars a month and you make that contribution. Wanted to give Jason a chance to weigh in here about some of the resources that you're aware of that some of our viewers might tap into. There's certainly the book,
The
Philosophy of Sustainable Design. What else can you share with us?
Well, I would definitely invite people to learn more about the Cascadia Region Green Building Council, CascadiaGBC.org. We have a newsletter that is a free newsletter that people can sign up for on our website.
Great.
And it connects you to all the activities, lots of free education events that not only we're doing but others are doing, and some paid events that are really amazing, some conferences, workshops, and seminars. So I would encourage people to do that. If they're interested in LEED, the best place is the U.S. Green Building Council website, usgbc.org. Locally, Better Bricks is fantastic, and Earth Advantage, as you mentioned. So there's really some great resources, especially in Oregon. There's some great people here.
Yeah, let's talk about, there are a few different programs for homes that rate them or evaluate them or certify them. And so obviously we have LEED, and we saw an example on the video of an Earth Advantage home. Mm-hmm. So what are the other programs that you're aware of in the Pacific Northwest and nationally?
Well, there's the Built Green program, which is popular in Washington, especially near Seattle, where I live. Mm-hmm. And you know, really, communities all over the U.S. in particular have these different rating systems that kind of crept up organically. Mm-hmm. Since the 80s, the first one was one called the Austin Green Building Program, and it was the first one in the country. It was prior to LEED. So there are, those resources are really out there if people Google them. But, you know, LEED for Homes, Earth Advantage, those kind of programs that are really
at
the
forefront.
Isn't there
an Energy Star for
Homes? There's Energy Star, yeah. Mm-hmm. It looks at energy more than other things. So we like people to think about all the issues, not just energy.
And that's an important thing to think about,
right,
as you look at it. If it's just a program out of the utility, they might just be thinking
focusing on
energy and not the larger picture.
Yeah.
We should also plug for our local viewers the Portland Office of Sustainable Development that's got a number of resources and lots of good advice and can help you out with things,
and
too.
And often some great training programs.
And Better Bricks offers a lot of training.
Oh, they sure do.
I know
and
that they used
great.
To come to businesses for free and do brown bag presentations and things.
Yeah, and they're just a real leader in pushing, especially energy efficiency mm-hmm. issues, real leader in that area. So we work with them all the time. Mm-hmm.
And anything anybody does around energy efficiency, they should definitely check with the state energy office, and they should also check with the energy trust to find out whether there are rebates or tax credits or things or low interest loans that they can get.
Yep.
And the utilities are still doing energy audits for people too, so you can come out and walk through your house and let you know where you might be able to make improvements, at least on that front.
Yeah, and you know, there's a lot of experts just in the community. People, you know, need to feel comfortable asking their local architect or engineer to give them pointers. There's so many things that you can do at your house that are simple. So
especially in this environment, in this community, my husband's an architect, and these days not being LEED certified can be a career killer, and that's good news for you.
That's amazing. Well, thank you for the work you do. I mean, it's just amazing how this has all taken off and grown, and LEED spread beyond this country into the world. That's just amazing.
Yep.
So thank you, Jason,
thank
for
you.
Coming. And
it.
This is, I think, a wrap for this day's show. And
yeah, special thank you to Laughing Planet for the food that keeps our crew alive and running here.
And we want to thank Natural House one more time for sharing the video segments with us. And also invite you, if you'd like to volunteer to help make this show possible, visit sustainabletoday.org and check out some of the volunteer opportunities. Thanks for joining us.
There's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home. It's where I live. You and many others live here too. The earth is our home. It's where we live. We can feel the power of the noonday sun, a blazing ball of fire up above, shining light and warmth enough for everyone, a gift to every nation from a star. There's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home, it's where I live. You and many others live here too. The earth is our home.